Pastor John for the opportunity, but my sense is the situation kind of caused some of it. So we'll move forward with that and still say thanks for the opportunity, but not for the situation itself. Most of you are going through some that I just found out this morning. And as we were even talking and doing Bible study, my brother from in Nigeria sent me a video, a snapshot video. All I saw was a car burning, and I think there's something going on, and I have resisted the urge to look at it, because if I do, I may not, I may end up not finishing my assignment for the day. So we'll go to God and pray in a minute. Some preambles for what we're doing here. If you're listening and you hear something that you think is different from what Pastor John has preached all along, you may want to reach out to me by text, because my intent is not to do that. Or you hear something you think goes against anything that Sister Trashanda did last week, again, all I'm doing is adding on to what has already been built. So today, the topic is, we're still talking about generational wealth, but I'm using the words inheritance, but they mean the same thing. Inheritance, generational wealth. My title is, I Must Fearlessly Live My Inheritance. I must fearlessly live my inheritance. Inheritance is something that you get. And if you are a child of God, which you already are, you already have an inheritance. Amen. The issue isn't, do you have one? The issue is, do I know that I have one? And have I been living into it? So let's pray and ask God for guidance in delivering this. I'm pretty nervous. I usually am not, but I am for different reasons that I wouldn't really, it's not important for you to know. But I'm praying that God will, through all of that, bring out what is important to you where you sit. So let's pray. Our Father and our God, we are grateful. We're grateful now for the things that have happened. But we're grateful that even in those things, you are present. Especially in those things, even when it sounds like you're silent and we want to run to you and complain and say, why is this happening? You are present. For those who have lost loved ones right now, Father, I pray that your spirit will continue to strengthen them. I echo Brother Elder Gary's prayer, Father, and say, please continue to lift them up. Continue to show them that as it says, that weeping may endure for the night, but that joy comes in the morning. Not joy in what has happened, but joy because you, God, are in our lives and you're present. As we go to the word today, I pray that you order my mouth, that you bring out what needs to be said, when and in proper time. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So I have a whole bunch of different things going on that I want to share, and hopefully we'll get to it, and hopefully it will all tie together. It ties together in my head, but I never know if it's going to tie together in other people's heads. So here we go. The first thing I want to talk about today is a repetition of the Psalms that we read this morning, that better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. Lord God Almighty, blessed is the one who trusts in you. So you can start to see signs of this inheritance that we're talking about. That the fact that you're dwelling in the presence of God is itself part of the inheritance we're talking about. And you're going to say, how is this? But before we go there, I want to give you my sermon in a sentence. And this is the claim that runs through everything I'm talking about today, the common thread, and that is that God is my inheritance. And then I put something next to it that says, I can't give what I don't have. Can you repeat after me? I can't give what I don't have. Y'all don't believe that. I can't give what I don't have. 4 years, 2005, we just moved into a house. I got a call from my brother. He was in London. He had gotten there late. His tuition was, they were going to give him a full ride. He didn't have one. I had two brothers, one in Wales, one in London at that time. I had bought a house. Moving from Pittsburgh here, I went, looked at the property we were going to build. If you buy a property in Michigan, you expect the house to be where the... I went home 3 weeks later. The thing was 45 feet off the road. I liked the idea. The guy had cut it all the way down. And now I had need for retaining walls behind me. I didn't even know I needed retaining walls. The reason he did that, if he hadn't done it, my driveway would have been a 45-degree angle. So I suddenly found myself a year moving into a house for the need of a retaining wall. Took out a home equity loan, did one half of the retaining wall that I needed, and got this call from my brothers. And I went to bed praying and wondering. And I used the money that I should have used to do what I should have done to give it to him. What's wrong with that picture? Was that my money?
Nope.
You can't give what you don't have.
Amen.
Most of us, because we live in this country, think because you have access to credit that it's your money. It is not your money.
Amen.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You can't give what you don't have. I want that to be kind of background music as I talk. So, but the first question is, what exactly do I have, right? This whole message series that Pastor has been preaching was based on the Proverbs 13:22, I believe, that says a good person, right, leaves inheritance to their children's children. A good person. So today we're going to talk about what does it look like to be that good person that leaves that inheritance. So you may have been mistaken to hear the way Pastor John maybe started out, the way we've been preaching and talking about this. Sometimes we make the mistake of thinking that what he's talking about, what Sister Trishana was talking about, what Brother Steve shared last time was what? You go and do. Go out there and make money. Go out and do. No, that's not the issue. The issue is you become the kind of person that as you live, your normal life produces those things.
Amen.
See the difference? When you go and do, you're doing things out of obligation. When you give somebody money because you're obligated to give them money, and then you turn around and see them getting a Ferrari, you're angry. And this happened to somebody. It's won a Ferrari, but they got an Lexus. It's not that different. But they were begging money, turn around, get an Lexus. The guy got angry. I said, why are you angry? Why did you give them the money? If I give out of obligation, then I'm disappointed when you do something stupid with it. But if I give because God talked to me and said to give, guess who the problem is? It's God's problem. You asked me to give, I gave, they're messing around with it. That's God's problem, not yours. And you will be okay with that.
Amen.
Number one, it's not your money.
Amen.
Number two, he's the one that asked you to give. So if you give out, do that. Does that make sense?
Amen.
So you can't give what you don't have. And if you to be that good person means the first thing, a lot of this will come out of Psalm 16:5 through the end of 11 with some supporting scriptures. So the first thing is that God has given me a great inheritance, right? Psalm 16:5, Lord, You alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. So that good person knows that God has given them a great portion. Why? This comes from the idea in the Israelites, if you were reading along with us in the Old Testament, God is dividing the land and is apportioning different things, and he goes to the Levites and he says, you are my portion. I am your portion. Don't worry about all these other people. I'm the one. I'm your inheritance. And Peter comes in the New Testament and says, you and I are what? We're priests and we're a holy nation. So God is our portion. What is it? So that's the first thing. And this isn't the only psalm that claims it. Psalm 142:5, in case you missed it in Psalm 16, repeats it. I cry to you, Lord. I say, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living. And you may think this is all Old Testament, but if you come to New Testament, there is also a 1 Corinthians, which is not, it won't show up here, but it's a 1 Corinthians 3:21 to 23, that Paul says what? Because you belong to Christ, right? God is your portion. Because you belong to Christ, and Christ belongs to God. So in all of this, the good person is one who already recognized that God is their portion, and they belong to God, right? Now, the question that you have to ask yourself then is, Brother Tony, I'm thinking you're saying to yourself, what about, right? There's always a what about. What about the times when things go wrong? What about those times that I've been waiting on the Lord to give me a job? What about those times? What about? So what about? So what if you didn't know God? You didn't have a job, then what? What's the difference? Would you rather know God and be in trouble or not know God and be in trouble? Does that make sense? You're going to be in trouble anyway. That's what life is about. Life is about troubles, problems, and solving them. So you're going to have them. The difference is, am I trying to do it by myself, or am I relying on God to help me with it? And I'll leave to your imagination which is better. But as the man said, as for me and my house, as for me, so no matter what it looks like, this is the second point. No matter what it looks like in your life, when you say, what about? No matter what it looks like, you have to look at it that God has done well by me. Honest secret to you right now. If you get a chance, there's a book by Catherine Marshall, talks about prayer. One of the first guarantees of praying is what Jesus does at Gethsemane when he says, Lord, this is what I want. However, not my will, but your will. You can argue till the cows come home, and that's fine. If you're approaching it differently, that's cool, right? But the first thing is that the second thing is not up there. But the second thing is, no matter what it looks like, God has done one by me. And the idea in Psalm 16, 7, let me read it and then we'll talk. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. Your first belief when you come to prayer has to be, no matter what has happened, no matter what is happening, God is still good. Amen. No matter what is happening, God is still good. Because here's why that is important. If you don't think God is still good, why are you praying to him? Amen. How strong would your faith be praying to a God you don't think is good? You're already sabotaging your faith in the prayer you're getting ready to offer. And thank God that God is not punitive like that. Because he knows that's what you're doing. Right? So the idea is that I know that God is still good, that God has done well by me, no matter what my condition seems to be by the naked eye. The reason I know that God has done well by me is one simple reason. He is present. That's it. That's the point of God being my portion. If Bill Gates is my best friend, I don't need Bill Gates' money. That makes sense? If Bill Gates is my absolute best friend, I'm just using an example. I don't need Bill Gates' money. Why? Because Bill Gates is my best friend. He decides he wants to go to Saint-Tropez or one of these fancy places I can't pronounce for dinner, and he says, yo, assuming you could say that, you want to go for dinner, what do I do? You know what? I'm kind of busy today. No, you say, yeah, sure, no problem. Okay, I'm leaving at 10. I'll send a car for you. Right? Am I right? So what are you worried about? That's the same thing. Same thing. So because of that, because I know, right, that no matter that it says God, because I'm saying God is present, then whatever my lot is, whatever I'm allocated, God knows about it. He's present. I'm okay. That's a place to start that prayer when I start praying. The second thing, I got to make sure I got this right. Okay. Second thing is the idea in John 3:27 says, to this John replied, a person can receive only what is given them from heaven. That's the only thing you can have anyway. I mean, it's a powerful statement. They're asking John the Baptist, are you Jesus? Are you Elijah? Who are you? And they said, well, yeah, you must be the son. He said, no, I'm not. I can't even untie his sandals. But they insisted. He says, no. Why? And people were expecting him to be angry. That's why he says, I must decrease, so he must increase. So you can only have what God has given you. But thank God we have a generous God. Amen. Who does not deal with us based on the way we think. It says, we wait in Psalm 33:20. This is another place that says, no matter what it looks like, God has done one by me. We wait in hope for the Lord who is our help and our shield. In him, our hearts rejoice. For we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. So we put our hope in God. We wait and hope, and we know he is our help and our shield. He is our portion. He is the one we're relying on. But the thing that keeps us, so maybe we can, let's stay here for a second and think about, what does it mean when I say God is my portion? What does it mean, right? In Nigeria, there's eight of us. And when we eat, we used to eat when I was younger, same pot, everything. So the meat's the same. My parents eat, they finish, and they let us. Whatever is left in the pot, that's meat. In this country, when you're eating, you eat the meat. No, we wait, the meat comes last, because there's usually not that much. And whatever meat's left in the pot has to be split eight ways. Guess who does the splitting? No. My youngest. Because if I, as the eldest, I get to pick first, if I split the meal, what's going to happen? Right? So the youngest, that's the idea of portion, right? The portion is the piece that you get. So when things are divvied up, the peace that you get, that's your portion. And you said, that's God. God is my portion means that in everything I do, I acknowledge God. In everything I do, I understand that A, God is present. And because God is present, I have a relationship with God. I have an interactive relationship with God. That's what it means for God to be your portion. Those of you who are married or have young people living with you, or even older people that you're taking care of, would understand this the most. They are your portion, they are your possession, not because you own them like a car. They are your possession because you have interactive relationship with them. That's what it means in that sense. You have interactive relationship. I can finish the person's sentence. I can order for them when they're not present. Right? If you know the person enough that you can say, Felicia always does this, she looks at something and she says, oh, Tony would love this. That means you're getting to know that person where you say, so-and-so would love this. And you don't necessarily pick up the phone and say, hey, you would get it and say, I figured you would love this. And 99.9% of the time, what's going to happen? They'd be like, wow, you were so thoughtful. There's always that one little time where they'd be like, what were you thinking? But that's good. That's good, but that because what? That is a process of learning, right? Then you don't get mad. You say, you know what? I thought, right? So your enjoyment of God increases with your knowledge of God. That's how that works. The more you know God, the more you can see the prayers God answers, and maybe it takes longer time to answer, whatever. The more you are then able to comfortably walk in what God has given you. And guess what's happening to your children and your children's children? Your kids are watching. I watched my dad. I used to, as a six-year-old, I think he told me the story. I was watching him studying one night. And I went up, put I said, I thought you were the boss. How come you're always studying? How come honestly, I was asking him a question. What's up? He was doing his law degree by correspondence. He would go to work, come home, take a nap, play soccer with us, go back, study till 12, wake up at 5 a.m. in the morning, study, go to work. You can ask my wife whose schedule that looks like right now. You can ask her. Because that's what I saw growing up. And that became part of me. Now, I don't even know, I'm telling you this, but I don't know that I consciously said, this is how I'm going to live. But that's part of the inheritance he's left me. The first question I ask when something happens is, what is the right thing to do? That's the first question he always would ask us. Okay, children, you got us together. Here's what's going on. What do you guys think? I want to do this or do this. What do you guys think is the right thing to do? Honestly. And sometimes it would be in the form of legal argument because he was practicing to be a lawyer. So you pick the side you're going to defend. Why am I saying all of this? It's not so much to say that he was such a nice guy or any of that. No. It is to say that he left that legacy without really intending to. You're going to leave a legacy. Let me say that again. You are going to leave a legacy. Question is it going to be the legacy of a good person? The only way it can be the legacy of a good person is if you are actually a good person. You can't give what you don't have. So if you're not a good person and you're not living the life of a good person, the fruit from the tree is not going to be good. Don't be shocked. Okay, keep it down. I'm sorry. This is among family, so sorry about that. The next point then is, so sometimes what holds us back is fear. Fear that God won't do what he wants to do. So that's why I titled this, I Will Fearlessly Live My Inheritance. And David helps us out in this psalm. Psalm 16, 8 through 9. David says, I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad. My tongue rejoices. There are versions that will say, my soul rejoices. My body will always rest secure. What David is saying is what? His eyes is focused on God. And Jesus says, I always do what I see my Father doing. That's focus. That's the first thing. The second thing is, my right hand is a hand of action. In all of my actions, God is at my right hand. God is the principle, is the basis, is the person, is the relationship upon which I act. Does that make sense? So those two go together. My focus is on God. My actions is the way God would act. That's a good person. That's the inheritance we're talking about. And because that's what you're doing, you are not afraid. Because you're hanging out with the strongest person on earth. There's nothing that gets to you that doesn't have to come from that strong person's hands. It has to come through God to you. And so David says, my heart is glad, my soul rejoices, my body will always rest secure. And he says, I will not be shaken. That's up to you. You can be shaken if you want. That's a choice. Psalm 23:4 says, even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. It's not that they whack me in the head when I go wrong. That's how people read this. You bring them along and say, that's a cliff over there, sheep. Come on back this way, because you're going to fall off. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. They guide me. They show me how to walk. Isaiah repeats the same idea. Isaiah 26:3-4 says, you will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you. Trust in the Lord forever. The Lord himself is the rock eternal. So all of these things are not things you just do. I said, you know, let's think about this. This is what Jesus means when he goes in Matthew 7:24-27. He says, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine, everything that we've just talked about, and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on a rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. The rains will come down. The winds will blow. Inflation will happen. The feds will raise rates. Supreme Court will do crazy stuff depending on which side you're on, right? Russia and Ukraine, Israel and Palestine, or Hamas, depending on how you look at it. Those things are going to happen because there are human beings on both sides. The problem is not the system is corrupt. The problem is that whatever system you're running is corrupted by the corrupt human beings who run it. Because all of us have gone astray. And that's the issue. So the issue is, how do we correct it? We'll come back to God. We'll come back to recognizing that God is our inheritance. The other promise is one where we recognize that no matter what, God, my Father, will never abandon me. That's the fourth point. No matter what. So Psalm 16:10 concludes this, starts to conclude. It says, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful one see decay. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, the eternal pleasures at your right hand. As Christians, we rush from Psalm 16, and we rush directly to Jesus on Resurrection Day, and we bypass the fact that this psalm was true when it was written. It wasn't waiting to be true years later. Does that make sense? There are promises and prophecies in the Bible where we're guilty of this. We think those prophecies were just hanging in mid-air, waiting to be fulfilled 500 years later. No. Something actually happened. A young woman did bear a child. Right? It actually happened. So when that happens, So this is David, if you believe it, definitely saying, look, you will not leave me in the grave by myself. So Jesus then, we put it in Jesus' location later, but it had to be true. So it's true for you and me is the point I'm trying to make. But you don't have to believe it. Psalm 23:6 then says, surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the good person. This knowledge, God is my portion, God is my inheritance, I have God, I'm going to act, and I'm going to live now and forever in God's presence. So what are you worried about? Why are we fearful? So let me bring this back a little bit, and if we have time, we'll play a clip. Hopefully, it'll be a little more add to what we're talking about here. One of the things that we go to the Bible and we read about the exploits of these people. One example that I put in here, I said, you know, I will set an example for my children's children. And I used the story of Caleb. So in Joshua 14, verse 6 through 9, it says, now the people of Judah approached Joshua at Gilgal. And Caleb, son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said to him, you know what the Lord said to Moses, the man of God at Kadesh Barnea, about you and me. If you guys are reading your Numbers, you should have read this past week in Numbers. I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to explore the land. And I brought him back a report according to my convictions. But my fellow Israelites who went with me made the hearts of the people melt in fear. I, however, followed the Lord, my God, wholeheartedly. So on that day, Moses swore to me, the land on which your feet have walked will be your inheritance and that of your children forever, because you have followed the Lord, my God, wholeheartedly. So he demonstrated the good person we're talking about. Now, this is verse 10-12. Now then, just as the Lord promised, he has kept me alive for 45 years since the time. So he was 40, now he's 85. Since the time. So he said this to Moses. So while Israel moved into the wilderness. So here I am today, 85 years old. I'm still as strong today as the day Moses sent me. I'm just as vigorous to go out to battle now as I was then. Now give me this hill country that the Lord promised me that day. You yourself heard then that the Anakites were there and their cities were large and fortified, but the Lord helping me, I will drive them out, just as he said. So he's claiming his promise 45 years later. I don't know how many of you would pray a prayer for 45 years and still hold on to it. Interesting. But the thing, I got to thinking about this. I will set an example for my children's children. I was going to use his example, Caleb. And then I said, you know, a lot of people get freaked out because he talks about what? Fighting, going to war. And I don't know about you, going to war doesn't appeal to a lot of people, right? You don't have to go get that. Especially back then, you got the machetes going and so forth. It's not like now where you can sit in your, somebody can sit in D.C. and play video games and send. So I said, well, what can we do to make this? So yeah, I'm going to beg your indulgence. It's like a two-minute. This is a movie. Those of you who know Priscilla knows, Priscilla was a movie buff. And this movie is called Defending Your Life. So this is the clip at the end. But let me set it up real quick. Hopefully we'll be able to play it. Defending Your Life, Meryl Streep. I can't remember the guy's name now. Albert Brooks, I believe. Both of them in this movie. The whole idea of the movie was fear. Fear. This guy was very fearful, and all his life he lived in fear, and this is like final judgment. He's in Judgment City, right? On his way to heaven, depending on your conception of heaven. He's in Judgment City, and the question is, are you still fearful? If you're fearful, the way the movie is setting it up, you go back to earth. If you're a Christian, you go to hell. Okay. But if you're not fearful, so that's what this is. So I want to use it as kind of a different way of looking at this idea of living an inheritance for your children's children. So if you, I don't know if you're able to play it. If not, okay. Just like 2 minutes.
All personnel, please prepare for departure.
I won't let you go.
So if you're a movie buff and you haven't seen the movie, I probably ruined the ending for you. My apologies. But I figured this was kind of a serious subject, and sometimes I can get up here. I've been accused of going, making things real deep and solemn and so forth. But I figured this is kind of a lighthearted way to also show you a different angle of what I'm talking about by fearlessly living my inheritance. This is an idea that God has given me something on the inside. Sometimes it's something only you know, right? Sometimes it's only, Felicia mentioned this morning, I hadn't remembered it, how much energy I had spent in 2019, energy and money, trying to get my entire family back to Nigeria to visit my dad at Christmas. We managed to finally go, right? And that was 2019, December. By November of 2020, he died. And that was the first time that all my kids, and extended and otherwise, we all were able to see him in his own element hanging around in his house. And that, I think, honestly, has changed a few of my kids' relationship with me because they saw me in a different light there. If you see me in Nigeria, I'm not the same person. Most Nigerians, most people who are in a foreign country, only Americans act the same way when they travel. but the idea was something, she mentioned that, yeah, something in me said, you have to do this, right? And sometimes that God has placed that in you, that everybody's looking at you like you're crazy. The important thing is knowing that God has placed it in you, that you're not doing something that's cheating somebody, messing somebody, doing something that is illegal. That's not what I'm talking about. God doesn't place in your heart to go rob a bank, right? If you have that kind of epiphany, ask a few other brothers and sisters before you take off. Nor does God place in your heart. When if what you're getting ready to do, the question is, Is this loving? Is this an act of love to the person or people on the other side of my actions? If you're not sure, stop. That's what the whole point is. It has to be an act of love. It has to be something that I love my neighbor as myself. If I was in that person's position, would I want somebody else to do the same thing to me? If the answer is no, stop. So a good person is one that looks at all of their life through the lens of God, the way God would look at it, and they stand where God would stand. And if you don't know God today, my appeal to you is to, if nothing else, ask him to help you know him. That's what this is all about, so that you're able to live that inheritance, and as you live it, you're actually passing it on to those around you. Okay? That's my argument for you guys today. So the idea is to give you that encouragement. Because what? Christ already died. He's not going to die tomorrow. Because he died, he has already paid for it. It's clean. It's like an etch-a-sketch. And it's an etch-a-sketch that continues to etch and sketch. Continues even as you are, like your kid. Imagine having a two-year-old running in the mud and you hosing them down as they're running in the mud. The important thing is at some point that two-year-old will become four and they will realize running in the mud is not the thing. And they will turn seven and eight. They realize, I don't want anything to do with the mud. That's the point. You grow, you get older, you become more and more like Christ every single day. So that your own desires and wishes line up with God's desires and wishes. So when you pray the prayer, Lord, not my will, but your will and his will be lined up. And that is a prayer that God answers without equivocation. So I'll pray out and hand it over to you then. Is that so? We can, if there are prayer partners are coming up, if there are people who actually want to pray, if you're looking to rededicate your life, if you're looking to reconnect with God, whatever it is you're looking to, because salvation is not just a one and done thing. You pray a prayer, you're able to walk into the kingdom of God. But you're already in God's kingdom. The difference is you don't know it. So whatever God is doing is blind to you. You don't, and what you don't know, like I said earlier, I can't give what I don't have. So we're asking you to come on in, walk with God if you're already hesitating. Right now, if there's any hesitations, drop all of that. Father, we thank you. We thank you and we glorify you. We know that too much words have been said already, but we know that your spirit is the one that will superintend all the words that have been said, that will help make sense of it in people's heads and minds and hearts. Above all, make sense of it, because it says, where my head and my heart faces, the rest of my foot will follow. Right now, I pray, Father, that our head and our heart will be faced towards you, that we'll be focused on you, on your Son, Jesus Christ, and the love that you've already poured out for us. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name.